Good morning and welcome to Dublin City FM. You're listening to Council Matters with myself, Mick FitzGerald. And today we officially start our coverage of LE19, as I'm calling it, or the local elections, which will be taking place in May. And I'm delighted to welcome back one of our graduates from LE14, Councillor Ted Leddy. So, Ted, welcome back.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Mick. I'm delighted to be here.
Ted,
and can I just say before I start, in all sincerity, thanks very much for your interest in local government, because there's a lot of people in the media who don't really know much about it or have any interest in about it, but you're definitely an exception. So thanks so much.
Well, as I say to people, it's not the sexy end of government, and to a certain degree, that's probably no bad thing, because certain things get done, and we'll come to that one, Ted, because I'm very interested, particularly in looking at how you go about your business out there in Fingal. But Ted, you're Fine Gael, you're representing Castleknock out there on Fingal Council. You're going again, I gather, in 2019.
Yeah, I'm up for re-election. Running a second time, I think, is very different than the first time. The first time, I think, the electorate are kind of saying, we might give this person a shot.
Yeah.
But the second time, you know, you're running on your record. So I feel reasonably confident that I'm in a position to do that. But just also as well, just to clarify, running in Castleknock, you know, it's the Castleknock Ward. It's a lot bigger than just, you know, Castleknock area. Sometimes people think when you say you're running in Castleknock, it's sort of a one-dimensional, affluent
just
area.
Just the centre of Castleknock,
yeah. Yeah, but it's the Castleknock Ward, so it would be all of Castleknock, all of Blanchardstown, all of Carpenterstown, bits of Cllr, bits of Mulhudder. So it's a fascinating area. It's got every challenge you can imagine. It's got kind of affluent areas and disadvantaged areas and everything in between.
It would have all the demographics, as we say.
Yeah, very much so. And you're right there. There'd be a large amount of new Irish there. There's a strong travelling community there. There's everything, you know, and every challenge that society is facing there, you kind of find it in my ward. So it's a fascinating place to represent.
Now, I'm going to start off, Ted, and I'm going to start off with what happened yesterday, and not in Castleknock or not in Fingal, but across the way in Westminster. Probably the biggest defeat I've ever seen of a government. Were you surprised?
I was surprised at how large the defeat was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, look, what can I say about Brexit that hasn't already been said? I genuinely find it deeply, deeply sad. I really do. As someone who's very pro-EU, very pro-UK, I've never been a kind of a Brit basher or anything like that. You know, but there was a thing on Twitter there recently, hashtag my first political memory. You know, my mother is from Derry, and my father would be in Cavan, just, you know, around Belturbet there.
Yeah.
And, you know, my first childhood memory is we going to Ulster final from Belturbet to Clonus, which are both in the Republic.
Sure.
But you pass the border twice.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, you know, asking my father, what's all this about? And him saying, I think this will take a while, you know.
No.
So I find the whole thing deeply, deeply sad. I really do.
Yeah, it's very interesting because I make no bones about it. In 1973, I voted against going into the EU. And I think myself and my father were the only ones in the neighbourhood that did. I'm now quite prepared to say that was a mistake. Now, the arguments that I used then are the same arguments that all the extreme left parties would use.
Yeah.
But it was wrong. I remember, going back to 1973, we were a poor country. We have benefited immensely from the EU. Is that a view you would accept?
Very much so, but my academic background is in international relations. I did that in college, and then I did a master's in international peace studies. And I believe very much in what John Hume said, was that the EU is the greatest peace process that's ever been in place. I mean, you know, with Trump and all the difficulties he's having with Mexico and Canada, you know, relations have never been worse, right? But there's three countries in North America. There's 45 countries in Europe, you know. So we have to pool our sovereignty. We have to pool our economies somewhat. Otherwise, it's a constant state of chaos and even war. And I'm not exaggerating by saying that. I mean, anyone who knows European history knows that there's truth to that. But so I'm a supporter of the European model. I don't think it's perfect. If you look at Northern Ireland, and I mentioned the border there, you have two different tribes, to be blunt about it, Republicans and Loyalists. We know how difficult it's been over the centuries. The European model is the perfect solution. I mean, joint British and Irish membership of the European Union has made a massive contribution to sort of eroding the extremes and eroding extreme national. And we've seen with Brexit that those relations are starting to deteriorate again. So I think it's deeply sad.
Many people talk about the fact that this is the European Union, or at least the original Common Market was established essentially as a peace project, and I accept that. And in that regard, it has been incredibly successful. However, back in 1972, when I was at UCD, I was studying economics under Gareth FitzGerald. Now, he didn't say it in the middle of the lecture. He said it in a private meeting when there were, you know, if you like, these select students were there. And he was very, very clear to us that the Common Market, or the EC, whatever you want to call it, was established with one primary function, and that was to stop the European economies being overrun by the American economy. And that could have easily happened. And I think in that regard, I would have to accept that it has been very successful in that regard. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I would, very much so. I mean, economic prosperity has been the big lure of the European Union. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you look after the Soviet Union broke up, you had 15 new independent countries there, another six or seven following the breakup of the Balkans. I mean, they could have went anyway, those countries. They could have become dictatorships or fascist countries or communist countries or extreme nationalist countries or anything like that. Yeah. But they all tried to get their economies in shape. They all tried to work on the fundamentals of democracy, separation of powers, and so on. And most of them have joined the European Union and are successful functioning democracies. So that's certainly one of the big success stories of the EU. But I acknowledge it's not perfect. And European integration probably did happen a bit too fast and was probably not, you know, I mean, the concern, I mean, you know, there are losers in globalization. I mean, there are, you know, and maybe, I mean, there are lessons in Brexit in terms of the European projects. But I always acknowledge the flaws, but the wins, the benefits, such as the peace, prosperity that I've spoken about, far, far outweigh the negatives in my view.
Yeah. Something in 2016, when we had the general election, I put up a page on Facebook saying, you know, basically with the big elephant, and the word Brexit written across it, and I said, what nobody wants to talk about. And this was, it very much was not an issue in 2016. Do you think in many regards we sleepwalked a bit? Now, I'm not having a go at the government, I'm not having a go at any of the other parties, that to a certain degree we took the that great Australian expression, "Shear me right, mate." And we're now seeing perhaps a very different scenario in that regard.
I don't think so, and I'll tell you why I'm saying that. The Taoiseach, the Taoiseach, and before that, Enda Kenny, have worked very, very, very hard on cultivating our relationships with other EU countries.
Sure.
Okay? And, you know, anyone who knows Irish history knows we've been in lots of negotiations over the years with the British, and we've always been in a weak position. This is the first time that we've actually been in a strong position, and that's because we have the EU backing us. So, you know, there's been, I mean, if you read Tony Connolly's book on Brexit, I don't know if you have or not, but he very much details those negotiations that went on. So they were happening from the early days. I mean, you can't control everything, and we can't control everything about Brexit. I mean, I understand your question, and perhaps there is, maybe we could have done things better, but we were in a very, very strong negotiating position because of our links with the EU. I mean, I remember myself, I was in Lille, remember the famous Robbie Radio?
Sure.
It was the next day, and I just couldn't believe what I was watching. I stayed up all night. I was the only one, I think, of the lads who did, and saw the thing, saw the results coming in, and I didn't see it coming. What can I say?
None of us did. Yeah, but then again, none of us probably saw Trump coming either. But again, and this is a very interesting one. In 1973, we joined the what was then the Common Market. Not because we had any great commitment to Europe or whatever. We did it essentially because the British did. So did the Danes, so I'm not going to knock it in that regard. Does that not suggest that somehow or other we should be following the British advice? Because it doesn't seem we've diversified our economy an enormous amount in the last, say, 45, 50 years to the degree that we should have.
I've had long discussions with my father about this, who's in the rag trade, you know, and he would do a lot of business over the years with Britain. So he feels very concerned about that too. But look, you know, as I said before, it's not a perfect situation. There's no, you know, we don't want to break. We don't want to see this happen. But like Ireland has broke with Britain before, you know, with Stirling and so on, and obviously in 1922. So look, it wasn't Armageddon before. I don't think it'll be Armageddon this time.
Okay, let's move on a bit to local government now. You were, I happily say to people, you were one of our first graduates from Council Matters the last time round, and we're very happy to say that 60% of our guests ended up getting elected. The first time I saw you after that, you were then, I think it was at Dublin Pride, you went straight in and you were Deputy Lord Mayor. How did that come about?
Yeah, I think just, you know, it was a strange makeup in Fingal. As you know, 2014 local elections was known as Independence Day in a lot of the...
Very much so in Fingal. Fingal, wasn't it?
Very much so in Fingal, yeah. So we had only six from 40, but we were in a group with Fianna Fáil and Labour. And there was a bit of dispute about who would be mayor in the first year and who would be deputy mayor. And I offered myself up and there was a vote and I won it narrowly. And it was a great experience, it really was, because I would have had certain perceptions about local government beforehand. But, you know, I began to realise that local authorities and local government, you know, it's not just about, you know, the roads and the footpaths and the social housing. There's a community aspect there. And, I became very familiar with other parts of the county. I mean, I ran the Castleknock Ward, but I became very familiar with them. You know, obviously places in Balbriggan and Holt and Malahide and Swords and so on. And as a result, I became a Fingal man as a result, you know, and very concerned about the future of Fingal and the wider Fingal, that is, you know.
It was when I looked at the makeup of the council, there are a lot, probably compared to any of the others, you've got more independents. But they seem to work with the council. Now, that's surprising compared to the way it works on Dublin City Council.
Yeah, well, there's independence and then there's independence.
Yeah. Oh, sure, yeah.
There's
yeah.
some authentic independents yeah. and there's some independents who lost out a selection convention yeah. and are really belong to...
other parties.
Yeah, exactly,
yes,
you know. Yeah. But, yeah, look, it's not the worst in that sense. It's not as bad as Dublin City, frankly, you know, or it's not as bad as South Dublin County Council. You know, we have worked together on some issues. But, you know, there are some people on the council, frankly, that are, and I won't name them, but who are very belligerent and who oppose anything the council ever tried to do, or won't support any budget, won't support any proposal, you know. And then when it goes forward, they're the first to complain that it's not been done enough, you know.
Sure.
So, but look, that's politics.
Yeah. I have said to people, particularly after looking at Dublin City Council, that the role of the councillor, the primary role of the councillor, is to hold the executive to task. In other words, to be an oversight on the executive. That seems to work better on Fingal than it does on Dublin City Council. Am I being a bit too generous there?
No, but I think you generally described it very well, the role of a councillor, and it took me a while to realise this, but there is this healthy tension between the elected members and management, and that's correct. That's the way it should be. I got a laugh in the council there recently when I said, and I didn't mean to really be joking about it, but I don't think that Fingal should be run the way, you know, the Healy Rays run Kerry, like, you know what I mean? It's not, you know, decisions...
It's not a family business.
Well, decisions shouldn't be made because, like, I'm not an expert, I'm not an engineer.
Yeah.
You know, the public regularly lobby me about certain things, I make the case, I bring it to the council, sometimes I'm successful, sometimes I'm not. But because I'm lobbied by the public, that shouldn't override a decision by a professional.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
you know?
Sure, no.
But having said that, we do have our pulse on the, you know, we do have a finger on the pulse of how the community are feeling about a lot of issues. And we do have solid information about how things work in the community. So we should be listened to. And there are executive powers that the councillors have. And then there's reserved powers that the councillors have. And then there's executive powers. And it's right that there's a healthy kind of give and take and a bit of rivalry there, you know.
Yeah, no, one of the things I've noticed, and I may be, again, being a bit naive on this, because I don't tend to focus as much on Fingal, Colin does that, is that Fingal seems to be more focused on government, whereas particularly Dublin City Council and to a lesser degree South Dublin, which I also cover, they seem to be more interested in politics.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, you get stage shows rather than government.
So. Like what regularly happens, well, happens occasionally in Fingal, and I know happens very regularly in Dublin City, is a councillor, usually from one of the kind of, you know, fringe parties or anti-establishment parties, however you want to describe it, they often will put forward a motion that has absolutely no role in the council whatsoever. Something that the council has absolutely no control over or no role over. The management will say that, but they'll call for a roll call vote, which is their right to do. They'll call for a vote on this subject matter and it will be defeated. Whatever, and then they will go on a massive social media offensive saying Councillor X, Y and Z voted against this, as if the council was the deciding body for this decision, you know. We see that all the time. That irritates me, I have to say.
Can you give me an example, because I'll come to some of the things that have happened on Dublin City Council that what would be an example of something like that? Because generally speaking, Fingal has not raised a lot of controversy. Now, there have been a couple of instances, but generally speaking, it hasn't. Obviously, one, I don't know if it got to the stage of having a vote, was somebody wanting the Irish flag to be taken down off the council buildings. Did that ever get to a vote?
It did, but the person who said that wasn't the person proposing the motion.
That's often the case, isn't it?
Yeah. I think the motion was to have the flag raised permanently over the council building, and then there was maybe a contribution from one or two of the sort of more militant Trotskyites who said, no, the red flags would be up there and not that type of thing. And I probably actually said it in jest, but it kind of went viral, and it's been used now by a lot of sort of right-wing groups and that type of thing. It was a ridiculous thing to say, obviously. Mm-hmm. But, I suppose that was one such example. Another example would be I'm just trying to think, offhand, I mean, does this issue with scramblers being used and trying to legislate for scramblers? There was legislation in the Dáil which turned out to be, it wouldn't have worked. There was problems with it. I think it was brought forward by Desi Ellis. And then there was kind of a motion in the council for Fine Gael from Sinn Féin to back this legislation when it clearly was flawed legislation. I think it would have changed what the nature of an open space means, and there was a lot of implications for that, for the Road Traffic Act and so on. So it was always never going to be passed. But like I said, Sinn Féin kind of then went on a social media offensive saying that we were against regulating this, which is completely untrue. And in fact, I think Noel Rock has legislation before the Dáil which were properly sorted out.
Again, correct me on this, but I haven't recalled Palestine coming up on Fingal Council, whereas it's almost a regular feature on Dublin City Council. What's the do they just not care out there, or is there just not the numbers to get it through?
Well, like you say, I think we focus more on government. I mean, we don't have a role. I mean, sometimes we pass motions of sympathy and so on, which we did on Monday. We had a council meeting on Monday. We had a minute silence in memory of the mayor of Gdansk, who was murdered, that type of thing. But generally, we don't tend to pass motions about subject matters which we're not elected to discuss and have absolutely no control over. I mean, these are issues that I have a massive interest in, and I will discuss them and debate them in another form. But I wasn't elected by the people of Castleknock to discuss international politics in Fingal County Council.
That's unfortunately Dublin City Council, to a degree, have... They've brought themselves into disrepute by constantly discussing issues that are outside the remit, whether it's trade policy, whether it's foreign policy. As I say, despite having a large number of independents out there, you haven't got people riding those horses.
Not really, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a sound assessment, I'd say, I mean, even to be fair, even to sort of the people who I would have very little in common with politically, and let's say, some of the far left parties, I don't really belong in that category, to be fair to them. I don't see very much of it occasionally, but like I said, it's a lot worse than Dublin City Council.
Yeah, Dublin City Council. Yeah, I mean, Dublin City Council, unfortunately, they expanded by 21%, and unfortunately, as I say, I'm not convinced everybody that came in is up to the calibre of...
I could be wrong, and I've made predictions in the past that were completely wrong politically, but I do think the next general election... I think will be a better election for my party, and I think for a number of other what people would call mainstream parties. I mean, I think we have seen, with the left-wing parties, there is a hardcore left-wing vote, but there's also another section of people who vote for that, who have voted for those parties, which is a protest vote. Mm-hmm. And I see that waning away a little bit. I also think the smaller wards... will mean less candidates, and I remember in 2014, in the last final counts, we saw a lot of my party colleagues lose seats, and smaller parties transfer to each other. I think that's less likely to happen this time, so I certainly hope. I think in Fingal, where we had six seats, Fine Gael had six seats, we're down to five now. I could see us doubling that. A good day. I certainly hope that happens.
Yeah, well, the smart money that I talk to suggests that we're going back to 2.5 party politics. Sinn Féin, obviously, replacing the Labour Party as the half party. Will be interesting to see if that happens. Ted, let's see, what are some of the issues out in Fingal? Now, everybody says housing is the ubiquitous issue. In Fingal, I can't imagine people sleeping rough in Swords or people sleeping rough in Skerries and places like that. Let's just talk housing from the point of view of rough sleepers. And is that being exported into Dublin City?
No, it's not. I mean, the housing problem and the homeless crisis is obviously, we talked about focusing on local issues, but housing and homeless is the one local issue that's also a massive national issue as well. So this is the one issue that we discuss every day, but it's also on the news, the news at night. In Fingal, we actually have quite a good record at housing people. we're housing people at quite a rapid rate. That's the way I see it. I mean, anybody in Fingal who was homeless a year ago has been housed, as far as I can see. The problem is people are continuing to present.
Yeah.
You know, people are continuing to be in danger of homelessness, and presenting themselves in the council in that regard.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason for that, as far as I can see it, is that we have a very erratic housing market. Prices are rising fast because supply is not where it needs to be. And because prices are rising so fast, people are selling. Which they're perfectly entitled to.
Sure.
But because of that, people are getting notice to quits.
Yeah.
They're being dumped onto a very expensive rental market. And people like that are in danger of homelessness. And I've met many people like that, people you wouldn't expect, and they have to present themselves as being in danger of homelessness. And what we generally do then is provide them with a housing assistance payment, which tops them up and allows them to get rent on the rental market. Which I know some people don't like, but while supply is not where it needs to be, and it's not, we have to proceed with measures like this to get people housed.
So what are your waiting lists like?
The waiting list is, like I said, it's moving. It's moving quite fast.
Mm-hmm.
We have a target, and we've built about, we've housed around 3,000 people off the housing list in the last, since around 2015. But you know, there is, there's still 8,000-9,000 people on the list.
Sure. Yeah.
And you know, if you're on the, if you're on the list at the very top, you know, as things are now, it'll be 8 or 9 years.
Mm-hmm.
But we have, in my own area, we have land that's publicly owned and zoned for housing,
mm-hmm.
and we're building social housing on that. But you know, Mick, I believe very strongly in this. You know, I believe getting it right is the most important thing. Getting it right is actually more important than doing it quickly.
Sure,
you know,
yeah.
I just finished reading memoirs there from Desi O'Malley. You know Desi O'Malley, of course.
Sure.
And he talked in his book about his time on Limerick Corporation in the 1960s, when you know they built kind of housing estates that are isolated, and people said that they would cause many problems. Like, we've had housing crisis before, and most people would recognise that. You know, the decision to sort of build tower blocks in the 1960s was a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe very much that, you know, building masses of local authority houses without having the infrastructure in place, mm-hmm. without having the services and the supports in place, that would be a big mistake.
Sure.
Now, that land, that land I mentioned about is a place called Damastown out in Mulhuddard. You know, we applied for the site services fund from the government. And it was granted, and that's like €12 million to make sure that the roads and the infrastructure are there so we can build a proper social housing community. And we've also built a school in the area as well recently too. And you know, these are things that have to be done if we're going to get these problems fixed correctly.
Yeah. Can I put it to you then, Ted, that when I look at Fingal, now I may be completely wrong on this, but I would have suggested that in terms of land, you've got very little, you've got plenty of land out there. So the bottleneck should be capital and, if you like, bureaucracy.
Mm.
How are you addressing them out there? I mean, capital is probably beyond your remit.
Well, it's beyond the remit of... well, it's not entirely beyond the remit, because we have now a vacant site levy, which is basically use it or lose it,
okay.
you know,
yeah.
which is, you know, and I've actually discussed this with staff in Fingal, where land has been identified that if it's not been built on, you know, a substantial fine. It's not a revenue collecting exercise. It's designed to get them to build.
It's a disincentive.
And we are seeing that. Yeah. We are seeing the land that is owned, people who might have been... Excuse me, people who might have been tempted to hang on to it for the price to rise.
Sure.
Those applications are starting to come in now, you know.
Okay. Yeah, let me look at another one. Because of the, if you like, the geographic nature of the council area, I would have suggested perhaps dumping is a problem out there.
Mm.
How am I doing on that one? Is dumping being brought to you as an issue, or is
it? Yeah, very much so. In my area, it would be the Strawberry Beds
mm-hmm.
and Porterstown, which is kind of a rural area, believe it or not,
sure.
Kind of surrounded by a concrete jungle. And it is badly, you know, it has bad problems with illegal dumping.
Mm-hmm.
We've looked at this in terms of CCTV footage, where we do for black spots. CCTV footage is actually very expensive. It is one of the problems, even mm-hmm. to monitor it and so on. I am looking at a motion myself which would be for my colleagues as well in across other local authorities, at increasing funding for this. You remember that RTE programme there a few months ago about it. Like it's horrible. It's a pet hate of mine. Yeah. I hate to see it. Mm-hmm. And it is a serious problem, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The other issue that, and I'm going back to my experience here at South Dublin. South Dublin and Fingal, I would suggest, have a lot of new people moving in, whether they're Irish or whether they were born outside the area. In which case, then, something that becomes a very, very important local resource are libraries. Mm. Is that something you would support?
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, very much so. We have excellent library facilities in Blanchardstown. And you're right. I do know that the new Irish, get great use out of them, mm-hmm. you know. And in fact, one of my colleagues who's running in the new Blanchardstown Mulhudder ward, Poonam Rain, mm-hmm. Have her on. She's a great candidate, and she's from India originally, and she feels very strongly about that. I think they should get. I know they should get all the support that they need from the local authorities and from government. But I do know there are new technologies which some people think is to the detriment of the future of the libraries. But these are all challenges now that we have to.
Yes, well, I was out at Lucan Library last week, and I've regularly been out in Talla. Mm. And whenever I go out there, it's packed.
Yeah.
And it's largely packed with people on the internet.
Yeah.
Because we take it for granted. Everybody's got a smartphone. No, they don't. But everybody has a need for that sort of communication, whether it's writing CVs or whether it's just even keeping up with their relations in foreign parts.
Yeah.
So, now, something else, Ted, and I just, again, this is not quite within your remit, but I was out in South Dublin last week. South Dublin and Dublin City Council both have LGBT staff networks. Mm. You don't have one, as far as I'm aware, you don't have one in Fingal. Now, obviously, the impetus from that must come from the staff, but is that something you would welcome?
Yeah, very much so. To be honest, it's the first time it's been raised with me.
Yeah. This is very recent. I mean, Dublin City Council has only been going for about 18 months, and South Dublin has only been going for 6 months. So, But I remember you. You spoke at Pride. You were only a councillor for a couple of months, and you spoke at Pride. So that's why I would imagine that you would be very supportive of LGBT staff.
Yeah, very much so. And look, we actually have a couple of elected members of the council that are LGBT, so I'll maybe have a discussion with them about that.
Yeah. Well, this would primarily be for the staff, so excuse me, the initiative would have to come from them. Mm. You're not going to run in the general election, I gather.
No, we had our selection convention out in Dublin West, and we chose, obviously, the Taoiseach is running again, and his running mate will be Emer Curry. Mm-hmm. I'll be working very hard now to help get both of them elected.
Mm-hmm. Ted, we're going to run out of time, but look, we wish you all the best for re-election in 2019, particularly as you'll be running out there in the Castleknock Ward. You're welcome to come back at any time and raise any issues, because that's what we believe in dialogue on rather than identity politics. So, Ted Leddy,
you're gentlemen,
it's been a delight to talk to you today. All right, that's it for